Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear.
Oh,
Will you please bow with me? Dear most glorious God and Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is to be secured and sealed by your hand, to know that there is no power in all the universe capable of removing us from your grip. Inside that grip, we find all love, peace, promise, and protection. We live by faith because we trust in your promise. We live by faith because you have loved us so. We live by faith because you sent your only Son, Jesus, to save us from death and destruction. You created us in your image so that we would be close to you and so that you could be close to us. Isn't that amazing? That you, God, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the all-powerful, the all-knowing, would create each of us so that you could be a part of our lives, so that you could hear our prayers and take the time to answer them. How is it that we can make so many other things important in our lives when you have made us so important in yours? Be with us this morning and fill this place in our hearts with your presence. Open our minds so that we can understand. Help us to become what you desire us to become. Give us strength and courage to be the people you desire us to be. We stand here together thankful for the gift of grace you so freely have given us. Help us to grow our faith and to more fully understand your love for us. Help us to learn to share that love for those around us who still do not understand. For it is in the name of our precious Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. As we go to our screen for our responsive reading this morning from Romans 1, verse 17. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. Praise the reading of God's word. Our praise hymn this morning, Living by Faith. I think this is the one that you need the sheet out. So if you have this, our praise hymn this morning, Living by Faith.
I care not today what tomorrow may bring. It shall the tempest may blow if Jesus walks close to my side.
I'm living by faith,
I'm living by faith, and feel
Well, it's a beginning of a new month. And so what happens when we have a new month? We have a new memory verse, James 2:26. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also.
For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. James 2:26.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see everyone here this morning, and such a beautiful day to out, and that's going to get in. I think we're going to have a nice week all week, right? Just maybe a threat of snow or rain a little bit. Take that. No, it's not. Threat of rain on Tuesday. Nobody wants to hear about snow anymore, especially after we planted gladiola bulbs and planted stuff around the church. So getting things cleaned up. Welcome to those of you that are watching from home. Good to have you in our presence, and we pray that the service will touch your hearts today as well. We're thankful to have you in our sanctuary watching us, whether it's on the internet, and I'll tell you how to get to there in a minute, or whether it's on TV. We're still on Sunday evenings, and I believe on Wednesday mornings. So it's good to have you here. We're still doing breakfast if anybody wants to come, and I know most everybody that's here has breakfast with us Sunday morning, but I know that we get this on our Facebook page, so if you're watching on Facebook and you're looking for a church, or even if you're watching on TV and you're looking for a church, you want to come a little bit early on Sunday morning and have breakfast, we have a nice breakfast here every Sunday morning, so please show up for that as well. The puppets. Now, if I've got this right, the puppets are on the 23rd. Okay, I did it right this time. The puppets are going to be on the 23rd. So mark that on your calendar. May 23rd from 11 to 2, we'll have the puppets. And then our potluck is going to be on the 17th. And because next Sunday is Mother's Day, and so we want people to take their mothers out to lunch and spend time with their mothers. So we'll have potluck the following week on the 17th. Also, I don't know if any of the kids have started to get letters from camp, but they should get letters from camp pretty well. I know that the check that I gave camp for the kids to go along with the scholarship was cash, so I would guess that they went along and accepted my letter and approved all of the kids for the scholarship. So since I didn't get the letter back and get the check back and cash the bank, I guess we're okay, right? So and to let you know that at home, if you know somebody that wants to go to camp, if you have a child or know a child or a grandchild or a friend that would like to go to camp, it's a three-day camp at Camp Judson up on Lake Erie for the kids first through the third grade, and then fourth through the sixth grade, they can go for a week. And we've got a really, really good program for them this year. And we got the kids a really nice scholarship where the parents paid a little bit and we paid a little bit. And if you know somebody that a child, we would like to hear from you so that we can make arrangements. We're going to take them here on the bus and then provide transportation for them as well. So please let us know if you know somebody that wants to go to camp and isn't. And that's June 14th that the kids will be going to camp. So that's not that far away, you know. I mean, just I know we've struggled and struggled. There was a period of time over the winter. I thought winter was never going to get over, right? And here we are. We're in the middle of May. It's warm out, and then I'm hoping that summer won't go by so quickly. But pretty soon it'll be September already. So we allow things to go by so quickly. All right, and then starting this Tuesday at 3:00, we're going to have our after-school program. Kid Fusion program starts Tuesday at 3 o'clock. And so if you have kids that want to come to a program from 3 to 6, they'll have crafts and all kinds of games and fun time. And we actually have a couple of teachers here that'll help with homework and if they need it. And they're going to say, no, they don't. But, you know, if they need it, let us know. We'll be glad to help out anyway, anyway we can. But so this Tuesday, on every Tuesday for the next month, the kids will have an after-school program from 3 to 6 on Tuesdays. And we'll feed the kids before we send them home. Also, while you're in that vein of thinking, we want to turn that into a summer program for the kids. So we're going to be looking for advice from moms and kids and everybody else on how to convert that program into the summer program. Anything else they need to announce, except for we'll have communion this morning as well. Any other announcements on the horizon? Oh yeah, I'm another one. We still looking for, if you have plants that you want to plant, or if you want to bring something out to the church, we're still looking for some petunias and whatever. But if you want to have something planted out here, the flower beds have been dug up, cleaned up, replanted some gladiolas, and planted the Easter lilies and fertilized the ground, and we're all set. So if you want to bring some plants out to have them planted, please feel free, because we have some room to put some stuff out here. And it's nice to have color. Last year we had such a wonderful spread of petunias out on the site. So the ground we got really produced and did well. So they grew. So I'm hoping we'll have the same thing again this year. Any other announcements that I need to make this morning before we move on? All right. How about praise and prayer requests? How about praises? You know, this is one of my favorite times, is that this, you know, when we talk about praises, God praising us. But I remember, it wasn't too long ago, but because, you know, probably everybody else remembers too, that I just, in my one car, I had to have a new transmission put in, right? And I got the transmission back, and the car back with a new transmission in it, and the brakes didn't work out really well. So I wound up having to have the car back into another shop and have the brakes work. And he couldn't figure out exactly what was going on with them. So he took the brakes all apart, blew them out, cleaned them up, adjusted them up, you know, fixed them. And then went back out, tested it, and finally found out that, well, I had a collapsed brake line in the front. So that needed to be... that needed to be fixed. And so, you know, I wasn't real happy about having to pay extra money to have the brakes done. Until Wednesday night, we were on our way home, and two deer running across me in front of the road, and I had to really jump on the brakes. And I know that, I mean, I didn't even hit the one, but I'm sure that she left hair on the front of my bumper. And had I not, you know, it's one of those things that you complain about them, but had I not had the brakes gone through, I probably would have stopped 20 feet beyond that, and I would have had an old car with a brand new transmission and front end, you know. So I guess, you know, God knows what he's doing, right? Even when we don't. Even when we don't want to pay those extra bucks to have the brakes fixed, God knows what he's doing more than we do. And you know, our thing is about faith today, and we need to have faith. We need to have faith that God is watching over us, right? I mean, I wasn't happy about having to pay, just paying $1,500 to get a new transmission and then turn around and pay another almost $300 to do the brakes. But look where I would have been if I'd have really mangled that deer and messed up my front end. I would have had a $1,500 in an old car, and then I would have had to spend another something big to get the front end fixed. It would have been terrible. But God was taking care of me, and I praise God for that, even though I don't know. And you know, I guess sometimes sometimes we have to, I guess sometimes we have to be careful not to act like Sarah, right? Not this Sarah, but Abraham's Sarah. Abraham's Sarah, you know, or we want to, you know, kind of just laugh. That's not, you know, but we have to have the faith of Abraham often. Anyone else this morning have a praise? Yes. We missed all of that. Okay, praise the Lord for that. Okay.
The Lord is protecting
us from that. Yes. Anyone else this morning have a praise? God working wonders. Yes.
Well, I have something similar to you with the two deer. I had two clients in my vehicle, and you know my vehicle was only this big. And I had two deer run out in front of me. And of course, the automatic mother's thing is, put your arm out, you know, and stuff, and but if it would have been just two seconds later, we would have hit both of them because they were right together when they crossed in front of us. So I thank God that He kept us safe.
Yeah, I, you know, and I hate it when they get across the road and then they turn around and they want to come back.
Yeah, but do that too.
Anyone else this morning have a praise? Your mom and dad are doing well?
Well, they're doing okay. I will see them next weekend. So my sister and I are both going up and working the flower garden for my mom. And that, she just loves that. That just seems to lift her up when she sees her flowers coming up and stuff. So that's been a thing that I've been probably doing for about the last 5 to 7 years now. And that I plant new flowers every year and try to put perennials in because then they're coming up.
Oh, I know. It just, yeah, I know exactly how you feel. I like the spring flowers coming up, and when my tulips and my tulips and everything coming up, I've got a series of things that come up.
Yeah, I don't like getting on my knees anymore, so perennials are it for me.
Yeah, we had a whole bunch of primroses that we planted last year, but it looks like only one came up this year. So, anyone else have a praise or prayer request?
Well, I thank the Lord for my health.
Okay. We do too. Yes. And for Ralph's, doing better, getting stronger, and
Ralph left without Patty this morning.
Yeah.
He came over by himself. So that was great.
Right.
He's come waltzing in ahead of her.
And his voice is getting stronger, and good. All right.
I thank God for the tractor. It wasn't the one you wanted, but it's the one we needed.
Yeah, I didn't have a preference, but I like that it has a blade out there, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, they were cleaning that up and getting that ready. That's going to be excited. Exciting. I'm excited about that, taking that wooded area out in the back, cleaning it up and fixing it up for a campground for kids or Christians in camp, and getting the bathroom outside and a wash area. It's people that watch us at home don't realize what we're doing here as we're turning this into a Christian complex. Open for people, so if you come by here, you know, we've got an outdoor theater, cinema. We bring the kids over and show Christian movies. We have a beautiful playground. We're getting in the volleyball court and a basketball court and trying to get this piece of ground cleaned up. That's funny, the piece of ground thing. I was thinking about that earlier this week because all I was hearing about was the drought in California, Minnesota, drought, and around here it rains so much I can't even get the rocks off of that field, you know. But I wasn't asking for a drought, so please know that I'm not praying for drought. I still want my flowers to grow. But it would be nice if it dries up so we can get some of that. But we have a lot of stuff that's going on here, and if you pass by and You want to just come and have a picnic? We have a picnic area out here, picnic tables, and we're open. I mean, we're here for people to use the church, use the playground, not the church, but the playground, use the facilities here. Yeah, there's a lot of wood out there for Jean. All right. Any other prayer requests? Let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for watching over us and we ask you to forgive us when we think that we're in charge and that you're not taking care of us, but we know that you're always there to watch over us even in spite of ourselves. And we ask you to continue to be doing that, to continue to take care of us, because as we look back, we always discover that the care that you take care of is always much better than not what we could do ourselves. We ask you to be with this country and watch over what's going on in the Middle East. And Lord, we ask you to continue to help us be the Christian nation. Lord, we're looking for revival to come, and we're ready for that. We're looking for the message, the good news to be spread in places again that have been shut down. And Lord, we ask you to watch over those that are suffering at the hands of evil in the Middle East. We ask you to be with all of those that are here today, and we thank you for all your many blessings and taking care of those and healing those and making people that were ill and that stronger, Teddy and Ralph and others. We thank you for watching over Jane's parents and for watching over the young lady that was with Sarah this week. Lord, we just ask you to continue to be with all of our young people. Last week, such a wonderful week with all the kids here in the church. Lord, we just ask you to continue to be with them and watch over them and have them grow. We ask you to be with the program that's coming on Tuesday and with the kids there and those that are working and with the puppet program that will be coming up soon. Lord, we just ask you to be with those of our loved ones who do not yet know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Yet it is heavy on our hearts when our families and our friends and our close, the people that we know and love closely, do not yet have salvation. Help us to be able to bring them to a place where they need to be so that they can understand. We ask you to work to help us to remove the scales from their eyes so that they will no longer live in the evil world that they live in, but that they will learn to come to know the good news of salvation. Lord, we ask you to be with those that are watching at home. There are many, many prayer requests out there, and there are many people who need your hand upon them. We think of Jim and Ann who watch us from Meadville, and Lord, we know that you watch over them as well as many others. That you know what all of our prayer requests are, and you know best how to take care of us. Watch over us and guide us. Be with our parents and be with our schools and watch over our young people especially. Guide us and direct us and help us to be all that we can possibly be. And we thank you so much for your love for us. In Jesus' name and for his sake we pray. Amen. I want you just to take a moment to close your eyes. Talk with God to prepare your hearts for communion. Communion is something that we never take lightly, we never take as something that we just automatically do, though we do it on the first of the month, first Sunday of every month. We do that because of our obedience to the Lord, our love for Him, our need to be close. But we need to be always prepared in our hearts that no anger, no hate, no unforgiveness, nothing stands between us and the Lord. Help us, Lord, to be all that we can be. Amen. Jesus took the bread and he broke it as he handed it to his disciples. We were talking about that in Sunday school this morning, about his trial. I wonder how many of us would sit at a table knowing they were going to go through the trial that he went through and break the bread and know what was going to happen next. But he allowed himself to be broken for us. No matter what anybody says, no matter how you analyze the situation, what Jesus says to Pilate is, I'm only here because my Father allows me to be here. Not by any man's hand. But it's sad that here he is, delivered into the wicked, the unsaved, the evil, who would not accept him. This is the body broken for us. After Jesus passed the bread, he took the cup, knowing that his blood was going to have to be shed for us. For without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. No matter how anybody wants to put it, unless we are covered by the blood of Jesus Christ, we have no forgiveness of sin. We have no way, no place to come to heaven. It took his blood. You would think that God could have figured out a way to purchase us by something else. But had he done that? Had he purchased us with gold? Well, then you would be worth, one 10 millionth of whatever it was, right? If he purchased us by silver, even that was created by God, right? Everything here. Your salvation had to be purchased with the blood of an innocent lamb. Jesus had to come to the cross, sinless, in his whole life, so that he could come spotless before the cross, so that his innocent blood not just innocent, right? I mean, it's just not innocent blood. We can't use that term and just make it so simple. But I mean, it was really innocent blood shed for us. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you because we know that you were the architect of our salvation. That you designed this way and this path back to you that Satan could not interfere with or disrupt. But that it took your Son to die for us. Help us to be worthy of so great a salvation, so great a sacrifice, so wonderful a gift. In our lives, we can never be worthy, but help us to try. By his love for us, we are made free. Thank you, Lord, for loving us so much.
Come to thee, thou.
If you're at home and here, please turn with me in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11. Now, I read the first three verses in our opening. So we'll begin with verse 4. By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he, being dead, yet speaketh. By faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and was not found, because God had translated him. For before his translation he had this testimony, that he pleased God. But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world, and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. By faith Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which hath foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore sprang there ever of one, and him as good as dead, so many as the stars of the sky in multitude, and as the sands which is by the seashore innumerable. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now they desire a better country, that is, an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. By faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called, according that God was able to raise him up even from the dead. From thence also he received him in a figure. By faith Isaac blessed God and Esau concerning things to come. By faith Jacob, when he was a dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph, and worshipped, leaning upon the top of his staff. By faith Joseph, when he died, made mention of the departing of the children of Israel, and gave commandment concerning his bones. By faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents, because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. By faith Moses, when he was come 2 years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ a greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians essayed to do were drowned. By faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were compassed about 7 days. By faith the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not when she had received the spies with peace. And what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and Samson and of Jephthah and of David also and Samuel and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead, raised to life again, and others were tortured, were not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mocking and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. After these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God, having provided some better thing for us, that they, without us, should not be made perfect. Living by Faith. Chapter 11 is also called by many the catalog of the heroes of faith. I want to look at this chapter from the viewpoint of faith, what faith has done in the lives of men and women in all ages, under all circumstances, from the very gates of the Garden of Eden down to the present moment. Now, when I put this sermon together, I discovered after numbering the pages, it was 93 pages long. Much too long for this one service. So we'll have to take a few weeks to really go through this chapter and on faith and do it well. But unless you want to sit through 93 pages of sermon this morning. This chapter illustrates the people of faith for you and me. And these people are witnesses who encourages us to live by faith. It is so easy to make the Christian life a series of rules. One of the reasons that so many people like to get under the Sermon on the Mount or the Ten Commandments is because men love rules and regulations. It seems so simple and easy to obey rules. Life is like that for a great many people. They want to follow a neat set of rules, all written down and handed out to them. But in this chapter, we are going to find people who went an altogether different route. They walked by faith. And that is the way God wants us to walk today. We will also see in this chapter that unbelief is the worst sin anyone can commit. God has a remedy for every sin but the state of unbelief. This does not mean that there is an unpardonable sin. There is no act which you would commit today that God would not forgive today or even tomorrow. But if you continue in a state of unbelief, God has no remedy for that at all. Verses 1 through 3, the verse I open with, is the definition of faith. The first statement in this chapter is a scriptural definition of faith. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. God has two ways in which men can come to Him today. Do you know that there are two ways? There are two ways that people can come to God. The first is that you can come to Him by works. You can. Yes, if you can present perfection in your works. God will accept you. If you can live without sin, God will accept you. If you can live a sinless and perfect life, you can come to God by works. But so far, nobody has been able to make it. Through all this period of time, nobody's been able to make it that way. Adam didn't, and no one since has ever been able to do it. Abraham didn't, and David didn't, and Daniel didn't. None of them made it by being perfect. Therefore, this is not a satisfactory way to come to God. But many people are trying to, hobbling along life on that futile route today. Let me give you an example. I like to listen to the radio in the car sometimes. And the other night, Polly and I were out late, and I was flipping through the channels trying to get to a baseball game. But instead of a baseball game, I happened across this channel and I heard as I was flipping through the term purgatory. And so I decided, okay, I'll listen to this. And, since it piqued my interest and truthfully, what I heard kind of horrified me. But this was a Catholic call-in program. And the lady on the telephone had stated that she had many friends who were not Catholics, and the subject of purgatory often came up. And her friends seemed to have much more knowledge about discussing the afterlife and what was going to happen after than she was able to do. She didn't have the scripture. She couldn't point to the places in the Bible to talk about purgatory. And so she was asking this priest to give her some more scripture to help her, so that she could have this argument, because she had been a good Catholic all of her life and didn't really understand all of this about purgatory. And she was definitely having a difficult time trying to have a discussion with her non-Catholic friends about it. The priest told her that purgatory was a place one went to wait. He explained that through our lives here on earth, we live with a lot of sin and a lot of selfishness as part of our lives. Really got the... And that we're not good enough to go to heaven. And of course, he got that part right. He said that purgatory was a place where you went after death to wait for God to put his arms around you and burn off those sins and that selfishness. That God was pure love, so that when he puts his arms around you, that would happen what would happen was that it would burn you. And that was what was necessary, to burn all the selfishness and sins out of your soul so that you were pure enough to go to heaven. She, like I said before, many people need a roadmap, a guide map, and she was looking for that guide map from him, this set of rules. The priest told her that purgatory was where you became pure enough to enter heaven. For some reason, it took longer than it took for others, he said. Some people it would take longer for some than for others. Through all this, the priest, gave no scriptural reference, none whatsoever. He never quoted a Bible from any place or source. I do not think by her remarks after that this call-in lady was either satisfied or secure by this teaching. The scriptures do not make mention of this. Purgatory completely defies the idea that Christ died for our sins and he took them away. Now, I have to tell you, I have this huge problem. I like science. I like things to stand on a mountain of evidence, of proof, a foundation. And when it doesn't, I have problems with it. I need my faith, but I need my faith to stand upon a foundation, something firm. The point here is that via this route, there is some way for you to work off. That's what's going on with the purgatory thing. That there's some way for you to work off your sin and become perfect before God. That somehow, by sitting through this and by waiting around in purgatory, this is how it works. Many people, even today, are trying to find God by and through works. And, oh, by the way, if you are not able to perform good works, that's okay, because you will have the opportunity to go to purgatory to have all those bad works burned off your soul. Now, What do we remember the Bible says about the thief that was on the cross? That he would be in paradise that day. You see, we want to work. We want to find a way to work because we have trouble with faith. It just doesn't work that way. And it never worked that way. No one has ever made it to God by this first method of works. It cannot be done. Not even with purgatory. And there is a great list of believers who attest to that fact. The only other way to come to God is to come to Him completely by faith. Many people don't find faith a very satisfactory way either, and feel like the little girl who asked to define, she was asked to define faith. She said, well, faith is believing what you know ain't so. That is what faith means to many. They think that it is a leap in the dark, an uncertainty, or some sort of a gamble. If that is what it means to you, then you do not have faith. Because faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence. Look at the word evidence. The evidence of things not seen. You see, which means that faith does rest upon a foundation. Faith does rest upon a foundation. And I'm going to stop there today. And we'll pick this verse up, this chapter up, and we'll discuss more about faith. And if you're watching at home and you have any questions, send me an email and write me. Our hymn of dedication this morning is, Faith is a Victory.
Along the hills of lofty Christian soldiers rise, and press the battle where the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the falling hills below, let all our strength be known. Faith is a victory we know, that overcomes the world.
Need to have faith like Abraham. Can you imagine having more faith, having the faith that Noah had to build the ark? That took a lot of faith, didn't it? That took a lot of faith. We need to have that kind of faith today. And if we did, can you imagine what would happen if had Noah not had the faith? And could you imagine what we could do if we had such faith? Well, may Esher please come forward for our tithes and offerings. As I say goodbye to our audience,